Will you put in the comments grace upon grace as we get ready for the word of God on this morning? I say blessings to all of you. Happy, happy new year again. Come on, y'all. You made it to 2021. Y'all, a new year, a new opportunity. Come on, God. On this first Sunday of the year, you know, we're still kind of in holiday mode. We're still recovering, resting. And so we're stripping down this service to the simplest format. The Lord had me to get up and just be me today so that you can clearly hear the word for today. See, today as we celebrate this new year, this year of revelation and growth, this year of clarity and understanding, there is a word that I wanted to share. And I believe this word is going to be foundational to how you navigate this new year. And it seems very simple. It seems like something that we know so well. But it is this. This is the word I want you to take. And you're already putting it on the screen. Grace. Grace. And not just grace, but grace upon grace. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you for this time, oh God. We thank you for your word. God, I ask right now that you would put your super on my natural, oh God, that you would have your way in this moment. Let them hear you and not me, oh God, that you would get the glory out of this word, oh God. Have your way. We bind up the Satan and the tricks, God, that he tries. He has no power or influence in this moment. Have your way, God. We trust you and we believe you and we expect you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. So our scripture this morning is going to be coming from Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 14. So I hope you'll kind of follow along with me. If you're taking notes, please take notes. Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 14. And it reads like this. For the grace of God has been revealed. Come on, that word revealed is going to show up so much this year. Bringing salvation to all people. And we are instructed to turn from godless living and sinful pleasures. We should live in this evil world with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God. While we look forward with hope to that wonderful day when the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ will be revealed, he gave his life to free us from every kind of sin, to cleanse us, and to make us his very own people, totally committed to doing good deeds. So I want to share a little something with you. When I was in my early 20s, I was on the road traveling from Charlotte to Wilmington. And I see my godmother on here. She'll know this stretch of road. I was on Highway 74. So if you're familiar with this stretch of road, it has a lot of open road to it. It's that kind of the road that you can just hit the gas and roll, right? Well, I rolled a little too fast, my God. Well, very, very fast would be a more honest depiction. I have always had a pretty heavy foot. My God, y'all pray for the pastor. But this particular day, I felt like I was good, right? I felt like, you know, I could do anything. There was nobody out there, and I pushed it, right? And I was going through this little town called Lumberton, okay? Lumberton is where UNC Pembroke is, but it's really quiet. And I was going well over the speed limit when I suddenly saw, what y'all think I saw? The dreaded blue lights, my God. And when the cop pulled me over, I was terrified, y'all. I was on my own insurance finally. I was living on my own. And I was like, Lord God, no. And I just knew, because I was going fast, y'all. I just knew that he was going to snatch my license right where I was, right? I knew he was. But thankfully, he didn't, since I was in the middle of what felt like nowhere. And I was like, if he take my license, I don't know what I'm going to do, right? But he wrote me a big ticket, major ticket. So a few weeks later, I showed up in court in Robeson County. If you know Robeson County, amen. I don't know that it's the place that is the most caring of the black folks. Amen. But I went to court young and scared by myself. No lawyer. Okay. No lawyer. And the judge called me up to the front. I remember it like it was yesterday. Ebony Freeland. And when I tell y'all, I was terrified. I was terrified. I was worried about what would happen. What would my parents say? What would my insurance do? Like, I'm on my own. All of these things were going through my head. And I stood there as he called me up, and I stood there and I was shaking. And the judge looked over my driving record. He was just flipping and looking. And finally, he looked up and he said to me, "Miss Freeland, you should be losing your license today, but I'm going to give you grace. Other than this, you seem like you're doing good things in your life, and I'm not going to mess that up because you made a mistake. You can pay the court fees and the case is dismissed." Y'all, I almost passed. I can see it right now. I almost went down right there in that courtroom by myself. And it was the first time that I really recognized the power of grace. You see, I didn't deserve the outcome. I didn't deserve that outcome, but grace was extended to me. I still had to pay a cost. Listen. But my record was clean. Well, not my soul. So today, on this third day of January 2020, I want you to know and understand that you have been extended grace. Grace is defined as the unmerited mercy or favor of God. It is the gift from God to humanity, right? It was given to us by sending Christ to die on the cross and secure our salvation. But listen, grace is not just this big, lofty theological concept or a churchy phrase that we like to practice. No, it is vital. It's vital at a practical and everyday level, right? You got to understand grace. So many of us talk about the grace of God, but do we understand it? Do we understand that it is only by that grace that we're alive? The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10, that but by the grace, my God, the unmerited favor and blessing of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not found to be for nothing, fruitless and without effect. In fact, I worked harder than all of them, the apostles, though it was not really I, but the grace, the unmerited favor and blessing of God, which was with me. You see, you have to understand that the grace of God is training us to live in a way that is contrary to the world. It's to understand that who you are is only at its best through the lens of God. See, we get it confused. We get it confused when we look at grace as permission to live how we want to. That's not it, y'all. That's not it. See, theologian David Gusick, he's one of my favorites. He says that grace speaks of the entire training process. Teaching, encouragement, correction, and discipline. Grace is a teacher, my God. Listen, God's grace showed up for me in the courtroom that day, but I still had to pay something. Why? Because I didn't have a free pass to break the law. He allowed me to not have to lose my license or go to jail, but with his grace. But I still had to deal with the consequences. I was taught in that moment, and I was corrected in that moment. But guess what? Guess what? This is what happens to us. It took a while, but over time, I got other tickets. I got other tickets since that time. Y'all remember I told you I got a heavy foot, and I've had to get a lawyer, and I've had to pay extra on my insurance at times. Why, Pastor? Why? Shouldn't that initial act of grace extend forever? No. You see, grace is not a pass. Grace is a charge, and it's a motivation to change. We got to take that grace and be honorable towards it, right? Max Lucado says that grace is the voice that calls us to change and then gives us the power to pull it off. My God, today. Come on, grace gives us the power to pull it off. Y'all ought to write that down. Grace is not a pat on the back from God. It's not him saying, hey, girl, hey, daughter, you're awesome. So let me go ahead and give you this grace. No, that's not it. It's him giving you the opportunity for a new heart. Y'all, it's him giving you the chance for a fresh start, a new heart. So when you receive his grace, Whether it's in your finances or in your relationships, in your health, in the courtroom, your next move should be Thanksgiving. It should be a desire to go and do differently, to go forward, doing something different than what you did before. We got to stop throwing the grace of God back at him. Stop treating it like it was nothing, like he had to do it. Guess what? He did not. You did not deserve it. But guess what, y'all? He did it anyway. Come on. That right there, that should make you jump out of your seat. That should make you give God a good dance, a good praise right there in your living room, in your kitchen, in your bed. It should make you do something, right? Because he did it anyway. Despite you, despite your choices, despite your attitude. Come on, just think it for a minute. Think for a minute about all the times that God's grace showed up where your attitude and your lifestyle was nasty, right? Where you made a choice that you know was wrong. Right? Where you did something that you know was wrong and his grace showed up for you. Woo! Come on, y'all. Y'all, that should be some hands up emojis going in the comments. That should be some dancing emojis running through. That should do a little dance in your kitchen because his grace showed up for you anyway. Y'all, I'm grateful. I'm grateful that even in the hard stuff, that even when I had to deal with the consequences of my choices, that his grace was still present. Because can I tell you that when you're dealing with your flesh, it could always be worse. But because you were saved by his grace, because you were saved by his grace, he will always be present. Even in the moments where you feel like condemnation is the only answer, his grace is still sufficient for you. Come on, when you feel like you've done the unforgivable, you feel like you've done the stupidest thing, you feel like you're the most unworthy of redemption, his grace still shows up for you. Grace upon grace. Somebody say grace upon grace. So Pastor, so how do we position ourselves to really receive this grace? Well, it's the beginning of the year, saints, and everyone starts making resolutions or plans and promises about what they're going to do different. Come on, some of y'all have said, I'm going to lose weight. Come on, I'm going to stop eating all that foolishness. I'm going to exercise more. I'm going to save my money. I'm going to be more present in my relationships, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But what about your faith resolutions? What about strengthening your faith through grace this year? What about growing in holiness? What about operating in your gifts? What have you resolved to do that will change how you think about God? Come on, have you shared this yet? See, as a church, we're embarking on a year of revelation this year, but we have to get a foundation of wisdom and grace first. You see, when Paul says that his grace is sufficient for you, what does that mean? What does it really mean other than it flows really well off your tongue? It means that what you have done, it's not bigger than his grace. It means that who you were is not bigger than his grace. Why? How? Well, Ephesians 2:8 says God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Y'all, he saved you by his grace. So you see, his grace was at work and it was in full force at your salvation. The moment you said yes, the very moment you said, I believe in you, Jesus, he put the whole weight of his sufficient grace behind you to push you forward. Come on. It wasn't a gift that you deserved, but it was the vehicle to your new identity in Christ. Oh, God, I feel a holler. Come on. Can I just speak to those of you that despite the joy and the dancing you did at midnight on New Year's Eve, that you're still struggling with your identity in Christ? Can I speak to those of you that still fight with sadness and depression and negative self-image? Come on, can I speak to those of you that are still fighting for your marriage in 2021? God's grace is sufficient for that. Oh, that my soul. God's grace works for that. God's grace is present in that. Whatever your that is, God's grace is sufficient for it. Come on, somebody. God's grace is more than enough. Sufficient means it's exactly what you need. It meets the need. It is everything that you need right there. His grace is sufficient and it's working. Come on, even this scripture about God's grace being sufficient is right there with the thorn in the flesh, that hard thing that was bothering you, that hard thing that you struggle with, that thing that God uses to keep you humble, that thing, that thorn that the enemy uses to tear your nerves up. What? Come on. But it's the same place that God's grace is sufficient. It's the same thing that tells you that when you're weak, he is strong. His strength is made perfect in your weakness. His grace is sufficient. So how do we bring that grace? You don't earn the grace. It is unmerited. You don't deserve it. But what can you do? What can you do to make your spirit right? Pray, study, meditate on the word. Take communion. These are all things that you can do to strengthen and build your faith and convey the message of grace to your spirit. See, that's the thing. We don't deserve grace, but we've got to convey that message to our spirit. Part of the reason why we stay sad and depressed and struggle is because we are not bringing that message of grace back to us. We're not pulling that grace in. It's a grace that's a gift to us. But here's the thing. You got to make sure your heart is connected to the Lord. Make sure your posture is right. Come on, you can be going through, but keep your heart connected. Come on, are y'all still with me? Come on, you can be crying your eyes out, but keep your heart connected. Come on, you can be wondering, what do I do next? How am I going to make it? How am I going to get through this thing? But keep your heart connected, and his grace will meet you there. Come on, I love how the Message version translates Psalm 51. Verse 16 through 17. Y'all, this blessed my soul when I was working on this word. It says this: going through the motions doesn't please you. A flawless performance is nothing to you. I learned God worship when my pride was shattered. Heart shattered lives, ready for love, don't for a moment escape God's notice. Do y'all see that? Do y'all see that? God isn't, he's not looking for you to be perfect. He's not looking for you to come to him already fixed up. Already, that's part of why a lot of y'all don't serve. I'm not good enough for that. I'm not good enough to be an intercessor. I'm not good enough to be an usher. I'm not good enough to pray for people. Why? God said a flawless performance is nothing he's looking for. He's looking for a heart that is shattered for him. Come on, when your pride was shattered, that's when you really learned to worship. Come on, when you're not good enough, that's what he says. Oh, but I am. I am. My grace is sufficient for you. So when you're not good enough, I supersede all of your weakness. Come on. It's the essence of grace. That when you don't have the strength, when you don't have the words, you don't have a plan, you don't have the understanding, God catches it and he accepts it. Woo, I know my soul. He will not despise a broken and contrite heart. Come on. Come on, God. We have to allow Holy Spirit to use our worship, use our study time, use our prayer life to transform our hearts, transform our lives as we go into this new year. Come on. We're not transformed by our ability to read scripture. We're not transformed by how well we listen to the word or how long we pray or how many times we take communion. No, we are transformed by how Holy Spirit uses those things in our lives by God's grace. That's how we're changed. We're changed by how Holy Spirit takes our stuff and uses them by God's grace. So this year, as we travel towards revelation, we can trust in God's grace to grow us. To grow us in our righteousness, to grow us in holiness, as we begin to recognize that his sufficiency, his grace, and his love is for us. My God, grace upon grace. Y'all, we have second, third, 10th chances. We have a Savior and a Father that knew where we would be on January 3rd, 2021, and he accounted for it with his grace, his sufficient grace. Saints of God, will you grab hold to it? Will you strive to live in a way that pushes you towards clarity and righteousness and holiness? Come on, will you take hold to who God is? Will you take hold to his grace? His grace is sufficient for you. So as we're talking about getting to revelation, as we're talking about authority, we're talking about maturing in the things of God, we're talking about going for the deeper things in God, you've got to understand his grace first. You have to understand that it is foundational, that you are saved by his grace, that you're here by his grace, that you can keep going by his grace. It's only by his grace that we are saved. So you see, I don't have an hour worth of word for you. I only have one: grace. God's grace. Come on, it's sufficient for you. And it's going to be the thing that when you allow that message to be conveyed to your heart, when you allow, again, it's not a permission to do whatever you want, but it's an understanding that when you fail, when you fall, when you do it right, when you're weak, when you're sad, when you're down, and when you don't know what to do, that his grace is present with you. It's present with you. So my prayer for you today is that you would receive the message of grace, that you would understand that he is for you, that he's with you. Do not believe the tricks of the enemy when he tells you that you're not good enough and there's no hope for you. That's a lie. We talked about this last a couple of weeks ago. His hope. He's the hope of glory. It's still there. It's still present just for you. So wherever you are, will you just lift up your hands briefly? Just lift up your hands and receive God's grace. Grace on your situation. Grace on your family, grace on your finances, grace on your prayer life, grace on your fasting life, grace, God's grace, and allow Holy Spirit to transform your life and your heart by God's grace. It is truly sufficient for you. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this time. I thank you for your word, God, and I thank you for the message of grace. I pray, oh God, that this word will reach into the hearts of many and that they will receive that message and that they will stand up in it, that they will walk forward believing and trusting, God, that you are for them, that you love a broken and contrite heart, that you can take that and you can work with it, that you can build us up, that you can mature us, that you can make us holy because you are holy, oh God. So we thank you today. We thank you for your word, and we thank you for your grace. So we thank you. We say it is well and it is so. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. I believe God today. I believe his faithfulness. I believe that he is working on our behalf. And I believe that his grace is bigger than disgrace. Come on, somebody. So I just admonish you to put his grace where, apply it in, throughout your life, because it's sufficient and it's present. So we thank you. That is it. That is it for Sozo this morning on this first Sunday in 2021. We praise God for you and for you joining in today. I pray that you are encouraged. If you know somebody that needs to see this word, send it. Send it to them. Share it so that they can be encouraged as well. God is so faithful and he is so, so very good. So we will see you again on Sunday morning. Sozo members, we'll see you on Tuesday for our meeting. And again, if you're interested in getting the fasting information, please inbox us and we will send it to you. We'll be starting on January the 11th. You see all the ways to stay connected with us on the screen. We're on Facebook. We're on Instagram. We're on YouTube. You can go back and watch this word if you need to be encouraged. Amen. God's grace is sufficient for you. I love you all. Have a great Sunday. God bless.